So we are talking about CPU scheduling. So we coined two terms. One we call it as preemptive, another we call it as non-preemptive. Then we are starting about this first non-preemptive scheduling algorithm, that is FCFS algorithm. So in this FCFS algorithm, we talked that we have three processes, process one, process two, and process three, and their burst time as 24, 3, and 3. And we are going to represent it in a Gantt chart, and we are going to find the waiting time. So average of these three processes, then we are going to call it as a average waiting time. So when we are in this situation, we are only taking about only the waiting time process. Now, how we are going to compute the waiting time? Just we will take look into the another application, and then we will start here. So we have process. We have this process P1. So process P1, it is occupying 24, and we have process P2, and it is going to occupy 3. Process P3, it is occupying 3. Then we have written a Gantt chart. So this Gantt chart we were mentioning, we have process 1. So all the three processes, all the three processes, they have started at the 0 time. So 0 at the beginning. Then process P1 is going to complete its job at 24. So process P2, it is going to have for 3 seconds. So it has computed 27. Process P3, it needs CPU for 3 milliseconds. So 3 milliseconds, this is the burst time. And these are the process. So it is 3 milliseconds, so it ends at 30. Then we have taken up P1 is a process, and P1 process has been done at 0. One second. So has been done at 0, and it is having a chance with CPU at 0. So we are going to get it as 24. Process P2, it is going to have its entry at 0 seconds, but still process P2 had a chance at 24. So we have this so we have this as 0 here, and this one as 24. Next, we are going to compute P3. P3 is going to get the chance at 27, and it has in the waiting queue, or it has been in the ready queue up to 20 seconds. So it is 27. Then we computed it as 0 plus 24 plus 27. And there are three processes. So now average waiting time. So we are going to estimate the average waiting time, and that estimation. And that estimation, we mentioned it as 17, right? So this is regarding the average waiting time. Now let us look into the new word called as turnaround time. Turnaround time. So what is the definition of a turnaround time means? From the process begin to the process completion, how much time a process has spent. It can be in a new state, it can be in a ready state, it can be in a running state, it can be in a IO waiting state, nor it can be to the terminate state. That is, it can spend at ready queue, it can spend at running queue, it can spend at waiting queue. So the total duration from the beginning of its journey to the ending of its journey, we are going to call it as a turnaround time. So the PPT what I am going to show here doesn't have the turnaround time. You have to compute it manually. So this is having only the waiting time, and it is having only the average waiting time, right? So how to compute the turnaround time? So now I am going to see the same diagram here. So the same diagram, if it is assumed, so up to zero process P1, it is going to occupy for 24 seconds and it is ending at 24. Process P2, it is occupying for 3 seconds and it goes up to 27. Process P3, it is occupying for 3 seconds and it ends at 30. Now, how do we compute P1? So P1 has started its journey at 0 and P1 has ended its journey at 24. So we have to assume it as 24 minus 0. So this is start time and this is the end time. So one, we are going to compute the start time. Another, we are going to compute the end time. So P1 is equals to 24. So what is P2 here? So P2 has started its journey at 0. When it has ended at 27. So P2 journey was at 27. What is P3? P3, it has begun its journey at 0 and P3 got its chance at CPU at 27 and it has completed its execution at 30. Therefore, we have to consider the end time. So distance between the beginning time and the end time. All three entered at the CPU at only 0 millisecond. Therefore, the start time is fixed for all the process as we are going to consider the preemptive. As we are going to consider the preemptive algorithm. So now here we are going to say it is 30. So the total, the turnaround time of P1 is 24, turnaround time of P2 is 27, turnaround time of P3 is 30. Now we have to find the average turnaround time. We have to find the average turnaround time. So what is the average turnaround time? That can be 24 plus 27 plus 30 divided by 3. May I know the answer, please? One, please calculate and tell the answer. 24 plus 27 plus 30. So what is the value here? Yes? Anyone can respond?
81 by 3, sir.
81 by 3. So then we are going to get around roughly
27.
So that is what we are going to get as a turnaround time. So this is this slide. We are going to call it as first come, first serve scheduling algorithm. Okay. So this one we have to met with the waiting time. This one we are going to work on turnaround time. So that is regarding the first one. Okay. Now let us dig into the second algorithm. The second algorithm we are going to say it as the shortest job first. The second algorithm, we have to assume it as the shortest job first. So I am having, so the title was shortest job first. So shortest job first, P1 is going to have for 6 milliseconds. P2, it is going to have for 8 milliseconds. P3 for 7 milliseconds, P4 for 3 milliseconds. So time of the burst time is mentioned in milliseconds. Okay, so 6, 8, 7, 3. Now, the first agenda of shortest job first is it has to sort the burst times. So which is the least it is going to consider? So P4 followed by P1, followed by P3, followed by P2. So now, what is the burst time of P4 means? It is 3. Burst time of P1 is 6, P3 is 7, P2 is 8. So this is the highlighted content. Now, we have to build the Gantt chart. We have to build the Gantt chart. So how we are going to mention the Gantt chart is, Now we are going to assume a Gantt chart is there, and so we are going to assume the Gantt chart. I am not good at drawing the things, so we are assuming this. So what is the process? I just P4 is there, P1 is there, P3 is there. Which one is missing? P2, right? P2 it is at 8. Okay. So now now shortest job first is our title. So P4 is the shortest one. So it starts at 0-8 interval. P4 is going to have a chance, and P4 is having for 3 milliseconds. So 0 to 3 P4 is going to have. The next one is P1. Next one is P1. P1 is going to occupy for 6 seconds. So 3 plus 6, 9 is there. Next one, the Q, it is going to occupy for P3. How much time P3 is going to consume? It wants the CPU for 7 milliseconds. So 9 plus 7, that is up to 16 milliseconds P3 is going to consume. Next one we are going to have P2. P2 needs a CPU time for 8 milliseconds. So 16 plus 8, we are going to get this as 24. Okay. Now let us start to compute the waiting time. Let us compute the waiting time. So P1 we have to compute, P2 we have to compute, P3 followed by P4. So first you have to, if you are going to write in this method, definitely you will have an advantage. So now we are going to see preemptive. We are going to compute the preemptive. When we are going to say it is preemptive, definitely all are going to arrive at the same time. That means the starting time is fixed. So starting time is fixed. Now ready. Now let us look the first process, P1. So P1, even though it has entered at 0, it is going to have an entry at 3. Therefore, you are going to mention it as 3 here. Next one, P2, even though it has entered at 0, now P2 is going to get the chance at 16. So 16, we are going to mention for P2. Next one, P3, it is entered into the queue at 0 millisecond, but CPU has put it into the running state at the 9th millisecond. So up to 9th millisecond, CPU is going to wait. So that is the waiting time. Next one, P4, it has entered the queue at 0. Now, as P4 is the smallest burst time, as P4 is going to have the least burst time, CPU has invited you to the ready, running queue from the ready queue, and that too at the beginning. Therefore, it has no waiting time. So 0 minus 0. Now we are having these elements. So 3 minus 0, 3, 16, followed by 9, followed by 0. Now what is the average waiting time? Please compute and tell me what is the average waiting time that you are going to get it as
28 by 4.
3 plus 16 plus 9 plus 0 by total number of process. Total number of processes for Anthema. How much is it?
28 by 4 is equal to 7, sir.
28 by 4. So we are going to get the 7 milliseconds as the waiting time. So we are going to get the 7 milliseconds as a waiting time. So now let us look into the second aspect, that we are going to call it as turn around time. Next one, we are going to get the turn around time. So how do we compute the turnaround time? The definition of a turnaround time is right from job submission to the job ending. When the process has born, when the process has completed. So in the waiting time, we are looking into the first interval aspect, but in the turnaround time, we have to look at the concluding aspect. So that is the difference between taking up the waiting time and the turnaround time. Now let us start. So P1, P2, P3 and P4. These are the four processes. And one thumb rule, we are going to use preemptive scheduling. So always the time what we are going to assume is static. All of them came before at the beginning, at the same interval, that too at the zero. Now, P1, it has arrived at zero, but P1, it has taken up with the CPU at 3 and it has been in running queue and CPU is processing the job of P1 and it has completed at 9. Therefore, the concluding time of P1 was 9. Next one, P2. P2 has arrived at 0 and it has got an opportunity to enter with the CPU at 16, but P2 has completed its execution at CPU at 24. So that is the last interval of P2. Therefore, we are going to get it as 24. Next one, P3. P3 has arrived at 0, but it has an opportunity to meet the CPU at 9th millisecond and CPU started executing the P3 process for at 9th millisecond and it has done it for 16. So it has done it up to 16 millisecond. So we are going to get here at 16. And finally, P4, it has arrived at 0 and CPU has started it as it is the shortest job in the 4 processes and it has executed it for 3 seconds because the burst time of the P4 is 3 milliseconds. So that is how we are going to get the turnaround time. So now the turnaround time will be 9, 24, 16 and 3. So now I want one or two students, please unmute yourself and tell the answer. 9 plus 24 plus 16 plus 3 divided by 4. 52,
sir. 52 divided by 4.
Then how many milliseconds we are going 13, to get it as? Sir. So 13 milliseconds. 13. So 13 milliseconds we are going to have it as the turn average turn around time. So this one we are going to call it as average waiting time. So this is the second way of aspect called as shortest job first. So we completed about the shortest job first. Now there is a challenge in shortest job first. Okay, how to know P2 is smallest? How to know P3 is smallest? How to know P4 is smallest? So this was the challenge thrown for the shortest job first. So
by considering the burst time.
Yeah, exactly. So that it is going to put it in a formulae. That it is going to put it into a formulae. And that formulae, they are going to call it as estimation of I plus 1 equal to alpha is a constant value, followed by the burst time as you mentioned, followed by 1 minus 0, 1.0 minus alpha and estimation of the previous value. If I am going to do my current value, I am going to use my current value. Assume today is 3rd, then yesterday's days was 2. That means the second we are going to call it as a previous value and the present we are going to call here as an I plus 1. If this is 2, now the estimation is 2. Now I have to predict the estimation 3. So alpha is going to be the constant value. Alpha is going to be the constant value. In some cases, it is 1.0. In some cases, it is going to be 0.0. And always burst time, you are able to have it in the given table. So P1, it occupies 6, 8, 7, 3. But who is first? Who is next? You want to have a prediction. You want to have the prediction of the next bus. So for that, we are going to use this formula. So this you can find in this literature. So the next one is, this example is a really interesting example. The reason why it is going to be interesting because we are going to solve this problem in preemption. We have to solve this problem in preemption. So what is non-preemption? I am getting all the process at zero. Until all the process is going to go at zero, I will not take up the process which are going to have at first interval, second or third. That is called as non-preemption. But now this example, it is going to focus on preemption. So what is preemption? My class starts at 11 o'clock. I will allow students who are going to be at 11. If I am going to get the students at level 1, level 2, level 10, level 20, I am not going to allow it. So that is the concept of non-preemption. But what is the concept of preemption? So in preemption, it allows any job which is born at one interval. It allows job which is born at first interval, second interval, or third interval. So the arrival time need not be static. The arrival time is going to be a variable arrival time. So arrival time is going to be changing. So the only difference between the previous algorithm and this algorithm is that one, it was the non-preemption, and second one was the preemption. And we are going to see the arrival times. So arrival times are going to be varied. Now let us work this example with the two aspects. One, we have to complete the waiting time, and another one, we are going to compute the turnaround time. So if so you can try it on your own, and meanwhile you can try it on one. I will also solve along with you. So if you are done, so you can tell me the answers when I ask. Okay, so P1, now we are going to focus on shortest job first. And what is the concept? Is it is preemption or not preemption? It is going to be preemption. Now P1 process. So I have P1, P2, P3 and P4. Four processes are there. Their arrival times are 0, 1, 2 and 3, and their burst times are 8, 4, 9 and 5. So their arrival times are 8, 4, 9 and 5. Okay, so now first we have to look into the preemption algorithm. So first, we have to draw a Gantt chart, that too at the half. Okay, don't draw the Gantt chart complete because it is a little bit complicated. I will tell you. So CPU started its execution at 0. So this is called as Gantt chart. This is called as Gantt chart. So now CPU is going to start its thing at 0 milliseconds. 0 milliseconds. Now, at 0 milliseconds, P2 is not there, P3 is not there, P4 is not there, right? At 0 millisecond, P2 is not there, P3 is not there, P4 is not there. So only P1 is there, only P1 is there, therefore it has picked up P1. Now, one incremented, so 1 millisecond time passed. Now tell me, what is the value of P1 right now? What is the value of P1? Please unmute yourself and answer. What is the value of P1 right now? It has passed 1 millisecond.
1 minus 2.
So, no. 8 minus 1. It is 8 minus 1. Because 8 intervals of CPU time it needs. So, 1 it is going to consume. Still 7 burst seconds or 7 burst time is going to be still there. Now, P1 is going to have a value of 7. Got it? So P1 has been consumed 1. Okay, now at 1 millisecond, with whom P1 has to compete? So at 1 millisecond, P1 state is 7 and P2 state is 4. P1 state is 7 milliseconds and P2 state is 4. Now please unmute yourself. Now, who is the shortest, P1 or P2 at time interval 1?
P2, sir.
P2. So now what CPU will do?
Allocate for P2, sir.
Allocate for P2. Okay. So it executes, it puts the P1 aside, that it is going to do context switching. So it is going to do the context switching. Then it is going to take up the P2 job. So then it starts executing up to second millisecond. Then it starts executing up to the second millisecond. Okay, now meanwhile P3 will come into picture. Meanwhile P3 will come into picture because P3 term is at second millisecond. So P3 will come into picture. Now what is the scenario right now? Again, tell me, what is the scenario right now? What is the burst time of P1?
7.
What is the burst time of P2?
3, sir.
Fine. Now, what is the comparison at the second state we have to do?
7.
P1 is equal to 7. P2 is equals to 3. And P3 is equal to 9. Okay. So, in these three, I have to use shortest job first algorithm. So, what is the shortest job in these three?
P4.
No.
At the second interval of time. At the second interval of time, still P2 is there. So, now we have to pick up only the P2 job. Okay. So, P2 job is taken up. So, then it goes up to the third millisecond. Then it goes up to the third millisecond. So, how many, now again, how many units of time is consumed by P2? Tell me exactly, how many units of time it is consumed by P2? How much is the remaining time?
2 seconds.
2 seconds. Okay, now tell me the comparison, what is happening at the third? P1 is 7, P2 is 2, P3 is 9, P4 is?
5.
P4 is?
It is 4th millisecond. 5 milliseconds.
So, in this, we are going to have the shortest job first. What is the shortest job first? 7295. Again, P2 is going to be the shortest. Again, P2 is going to be the shortest. Therefore, P2 is going to have a chance. Therefore, P2 is going to have a chance. So, what is going to happen was, so, until the P2 is going to complete its job, no other is going to come into scenario. So, no other job is going to come into scenario. So, P2 totally completes its job. So, total job of P2 is 4. Therefore, 1 plus 4, we are going to get up to 5 milliseconds. Up to 5 milliseconds, P2 is going to have in the Gantt chart. Okay, P2 job is done. At 3 milliseconds, P2 job is done. Now, what is the scenario? Now, the scenario was, P1 is going to have 7. P2 is going to have, P2 job is done.
0.
Yeah, fine. So, P3 job was 9 milliseconds. And P4 job was 5 milliseconds. Five. So, nobody at the fifth interval. Right? Nobody at the fifth interval. Only these three are there. Now, shortest job first. What it has to do? 7, 9, 5. So, answer is P4 five. Is equals to 5. So, what it is going to do the Gantt chart? Then it is going to allow P4. Then it is going to allow P4. How many seconds it is going to allow? It is going to allow for 5 seconds. So, what is the value? 5 plus 5. So, Until 10 milliseconds, P4 is going to stay in the CPU burst time. Fine. Okay. P2 is done. P4 is done. Now we are going to have two more entities. The first entity was P1. It is 7. And next one we are going to have P9. So in this again, we are have to apply shortest job first. So the shortest job first, we are going to see P1 is equals to 7. So, now tell me how to build the Gantt chart now. How to build the Gantt chart? So, after P4, what I have to write? After P1. P4,
I have to write P1.
Okay. So, P1. And it is going to occupy for 7 milliseconds. So, total it can be up to 17. Okay. That it is going to up to 10 to 7. That is 17. Fine. So, P1 is done. Only the remaining was P3. That is the last job. So, then we are going to allow P3 for CPU to execute and P3 wants 9 cycles. So, total 17 plus 9, we are going to get here as 26. We have to get it as 26. So, I'm going to draw the chart again. So, I'm going to have 0. First one, I'm going to have P1. Next, I'm going to have P2. Next, I'm going to have P4 followed by P1 followed by P3. So P1, it goes up to 1 here. So P1, it goes up to 1 here. P2, it goes up to 5. P4, it goes up to 10. P1, again, it enters and stays up to 17. Up to 17 here, and it goes up to 20. Okay, girls, now tell me how to compute the waiting time for each and every process. This is interesting because we are not assuming zero as fixed, right? So starting time varies from process to process. P1 process is zero starting time. P1 starting time is 1. P2 starting time is 2. P2 starting time is 3. And one thing you have to remember, P1 has two instances. First instance is between 0 to 1 and second instance is between 10 to 17. Both of the things we have to consider. So this is little bit complicated. So now let us work at this position called as P1. So P1. So P1, it has born at 0. Fine. P1, it has born at 0. There is no ambiguity. So when it has entered, no other jobs is there. Therefore, 0 minus 0. This is fine. Plus, at 1, it was terminated. It is not terminated. It has been a context switching. It has moved to, CPU has moved, had made a swap in and swap out operation and took up P2 there. And then it has taken up P2. So now, P2 had the second instance at 10. Has at second instance at 10 and it has left at 1. So what I have to do is, now the latest one is 10 and it has left at 1. So that is how we are going to bring the picture for P1. So P1 is equals to 0 minus 0 plus 10 minus 1. So coming to the second one, P2. P2 was born at 1. So starting minus 1, when it has chance with the CPU. It has chance at the 1 itself. So 1 minus 1. Next, we are going to take P3. P3 was born at 2. Therefore, the starting time, we are going to put it as minus 2. And P2 has an opportunity for the with the CPU to get executed at the 17th interval of time. Therefore, it is 17 minus 2. And finally, we should have this P4 here. We should have P4 here. So P4 is equals to P4. I'm going to have the starting time as 3. So, and when it is going to get processed by the CPU, it is going to get the process by the CPU at 5th interval of time. Therefore, we are going to have 5 minus 3. So P1 value was 9. P2 value was 0. P3 value was 15 and P4 value was 2. So I am going to compute the average waiting time. We have to compute the average waiting time. What is average waiting time is? It is 9 plus 0 plus 15 plus 2 divided by 4. What is the answer there? Divided by 4. So we should get this as 26 by 4 and it was 6.5 milliseconds. Unit representation is main, whether it is meters or centimeters or seconds or milliseconds. So representation is the unit mentioning is important here. So in the shortest job, first we are going to assume four processes, when they are going to join, when they are going to end. So that is what we are going to consider. So this is not still over. So we have shortest job first, and that too it is in preemption. That too it is preemption. Now we have to find the turnaround time. Now we have to find the turnaround time. So I'll draw the diagram again here. So first one we are going to have at 0. That is P1, Second, we are going to have up to P2. Third, we have P4. Next, we are going... Yeah, tell me.
If you don't mind, once repeat the waiting time calculation, sir.
Yeah, yeah. What I will do is, instead of writing the turnaround time, I will repeat the waiting time, okay? I will use the same chart. Then I will, later I will tell the turnaround time, fine? So, P1 is there, P2 is there, P4 is there, P1 is there, P3 is there. So, P1 is up to 1, P2 is up to 5, P4 is up to 10, P1 is up to 17, and P3 is up to 26. So, up to 17 here. Fine. So, I am not discussing on turnaround time. Now, let us look into the waiting time. Let us take up the same topic, waiting time. Fine. So, this is the Gantt chart we are going to take into picture. And before that, then I have to see the arrival time also. So, P1, it is going to arrive at 0. P2, arrival at 1. P3, arrival at 2. P4, arrival at 3. Okay. So, this Gantt chart we have drawn with the preemption algorithm. Now, let us calculate P1 first. Let us calculate P1 first. So, always remember, when the process has born, when the process has born, that one we have to record at the end. So, that is called as the starting time. So, in non-preemption, by default, all process will be born at the same time. So, always zero will be there. But in the preemption, it can be zero interval, it can be one interval, two interval, three interval. So, it is going to be varied based on when the process has entered to the CPU. That it is going to look into it. So, now P1 is there. So, P1, when it has arrived, no other job is there. Therefore, it is going to have the value of 0. Fine. Now, P1, it has done up to 1. P1, it has executed only for the first instance. It has executed only up to the first instance. So, its ending time we have to write here, that is minus 1. And again, when CPU got the servicing of the central processing unit, that means it got the servicing at the central processing unit at the 10th interval. Therefore, we have to write it as 10. So now, let us look into the real-time scenario in a doctor's example, what we were mentioning. So, assume P3 is there. So, P3 has visited the doctor at 17. So, doctor, he didn't recommend for the tests. He didn't recommend for any scanning reports. He has given some prescription and he has sent. So, there is no IO bound job. There is no IO waiting queue for the P3. It is free. But for P1, it is going to have two instances. So, why it is going to left here at this position? Because doctor, he had made a diagnosis. And he thought that he should go for some scanning report or some other that he then it has went there. So it has went there. That means this interval of time, it is waiting for another activity, right? It is waiting for some other activity that is scanning or etc. Okay, then it has taken up the scanning reports and then it went to the doctor. If you are resuming it, then again it has a opportunity to meet the doctor at 10. So, same example we are going to take. So, P1, it has started execution. It needs some IO. As it needs some IO, it is pushed from running queue to the waiting queue. It is moved from running state to the IO waiting state. So, it has been spending up to from 1 second to 9 seconds. It has spending outside. So, that is now still treated as a waiting state only. So again, it has got serviced with the CPU. Again, it has got serviced with the CPU at 10 millisecond and up to 17. So this one we are not going to consider. We are going to consider how much time the process P1 is waiting for the CPU to get executed. Only that amount of time we are going to assume. So we will be getting 0 minus 0 plus 9 minus 10 minus 1. So we will be getting it as 9. Later on, we are going to consider P2. Okay, P2, it has had an arrival time. Sorry, it has a initial time at 1 second. That one we have to subtract it. So P2, it has chance at 1. So obviously 1 minus 1, we will be getting it as 0. Later on, P3 is there. So P3, it has the starting time at 2. So we have to subtract the starting time. Fine. Now, when is this P3 in the Gantt chart? The P3, it has an origin. It has its presence at 17 second. That 17, we have to write it here. So P3 is equals to 17 minus 2. We are going to get it as 15 here. Finally, we get the fourth job, that is 4. That is P4. So P4, we are going to consider. So P4, we have to say that it is born at the third interval. It is born at the third interval, and P4, it has been opportunity to meet the CPU at the fifth millisecond. So we are going to assume it as 5 here. So this is waiting time of P1, waiting time of P2, waiting time of P3, waiting time of P4. So then we have to compute the average waiting time. So average waiting time, this is nothing more special. So we are going to see how many number of processes are there, what is the total waiting time. So that we are going to compute. So this is the part of the preemption. That too, it is the part of the waiting time. That too, it is part of the waiting time. So this is regarding the waiting time Gantt chart computation. Excuse me, my system, I think hardware is.
సార్ సిస్టమ్ ట్రబుల్ వచ్చిందంట లీవ్ అయిపోమని చెప్పారు.